Hi, welcome to this video. Here's a new retro device that I'm going to build. This will be a video digitizer for the Commodore 64. It will not be for moving video pictures, but for still images only. And this kit has been assembled by Martin in Germany. And now let's see what's inside the bag. Okay, here's a beautiful little PCB. And here's a few IC sockets and ICs. Here's a user port jack for the C64, and here's a video input jack, and here are two potentiometers. And in this bag, there's a few smaller parts, capacitors and resistors and so on. And here's even a cartridge case. And finally, there's a beautiful description that Martin made showing all the resistor values. And here's the complete list of parts. You wouldn't believe that all this fits into this small bag. Now a few words about the history of this piece of hardware. This digitizer was designed by the Austrian company Print-Technik in 1986. Then in 1990, the German company Scanntronik released an improved version of that device. And then in 1995, they improved it once again. And it is a replica of this latest version that we are going to build. And now it's time to build it, and as usual, we will start with the lower profile parts. And so I have prepared the resistors and the two diodes according to Martin's description. And so let's start soldering now. Okay, and here's the complete board. That wasn't too difficult to solder, except for these two transistors here. Because these three pins here and here, they are so close together, and you have to use very little solder here to avoid an unwanted connection. We can now make a few simple checks with the multimeter. I've set it to connectivity mode. We can rule out any errors in the layout of this board because this circuit has been successfully built a few times now. But we can check whether we maybe made an unwanted connection or maybe we broke a connection while we were soldering. First, we can check whether there is a short between ground and 5 volts because these two must not be connected in any way. And we see that there is no connection, that's fine. And we can check whether ground is connected to each of these bottom right pins on these IC sockets. So that's fine as well. This IC here has a different layout. We'll just check the rest of the ICs. And ground is also on the outside of this video connector. Okay, that's fine as well. And the same for the 5 volt rail. And this goes to the top left of these IC sockets. And these are connected as well. So that's fine. And now comes my favorite part. We will now populate the IC sockets with these ICs. Okay, now it's complete, and all that's left now is we need to put it into this cartridge case. Okay. I have just removed the lid again, because I forgot that we still need to attach the sticker. And we will have to make 3 holes in it. And it's easier to mark the positions for these holes from underneath. For making the 2 smaller holes, I have found this device in my toolbox. This will make a 4mm hole when hit with a hammer, and this is just the perfect size for these 2 holes. Okay, and now it's complete. I have accidentally made this hole here a little too small, but later I found out that this is a good idea because you can use your finger to stuff the rest of the sticker inside so that you will get a clean edge around here. And you can do the same with the smaller holes using a screwdriver or something like that. And now it's time for the first test, and we will need a composite video signal that will go here. And people in the 90s probably used a video camera or a VCR, but we can use this. Look at this. This is my first digital camera from 2004. It's a Canon XS2S. Let's make a quick unboxing scene. Okay, let's take everything out. And there's the camera. It's in very bad condition. It's seen a lot of use back in the days. And most of these cameras came with such a cable. Back in the days before HDMI, you could connect your digital camera to a standard CRT television and show your pictures there. There's some problem with the sensor of this camera because it only shows a black image, but we can still use it for displaying images, both on the display and over the composite video cable. I've put these 2 images that I found on the web onto the SD card. This camera is a little picky when it comes to displaying images that are on the SD card. You can't just simply put any pictures onto the card because even if the size is correct, the camera just won't display them. And so I used a little trick. I took a picture with the camera, which was of course entirely black. Then I copied the image to the PC. Then I pasted another image into this picture. And then I copied the file back onto the SD card. And here we have it. And here it is, plugged into the user port of my C64. And I will now power up the computer, and let's hope that there will be no smoke or explosions or something like that. Okay, the computer's running, so that's a good sign. There are at least 4 pieces of software that support this video digitizer, and we will now try the first of them. Look at that, the LED has come to life. And now let's plug in this cable. The yellow one is the composite video signal, while the black one is the audio signal. So we have to put in the yellow one. Okay, I've now turned on the camera. And let's see what will happen. And there is our image. It's unbelievable. It does not fit entirely onto the screen. And it seems to be working. That's fantastic. Okay, let's try the other one. And there's the other picture. Okay, so we have a working video digitizer. Finally, let me tell you that I've just found out that there is a much better piece of software than the original one that came with the digitizer in the early 90s, and this is GoDot. And here we have the load option, which is set to the digitizer. So now when we click load, it will get the image from the digitizer. Okay, now the red LED has come on. And on the right we see that the image is being processed. And we can now click display to show the image. And we see that it is trying to produce some color, which of course does not match the original colors due to the limited palette. But it still looks very good. And you can even read the sponsors on the car. So that's very impressive for a Commodore 64. So, that was it. I hope you enjoyed this video. Thanks for watching, and until next time, goodbye.